already the 8th devlog and my portfolio still doesn't have any projects on it. I know the portfolio is kind of the ultimate project by itself, but it's time for me to display some of the projects I've worked on during my career. And I'm proud to show you the final result. Yep, right from the beginning of the video. But hold up, we have a few things to see first. In this devlog, we're going to talk about whisper flags, references, cookie counter, overlay animation, server monitoring, and the project, obviously. Last month, I opened up an alpha version of the portfolio for Easter, and it went surprisingly well. Server didn't crash, players seemed to have fun, and I gathered a bunch of useful feedback. One thing I noticed is that many of the whisper posted contain messages such as "Hello from" followed by the country. So I thought I would add flags to the whispers. This way, you can proudly share where you come from along your actual message. I really hope this feature will be used because I spent so much time on it and I even resized and tweaked all the flags by myself. While doing the cookie stand, check the previous devlog if you haven't seen it yet, I realized I needed an easy way to target specific objects from the model. Even though it feels a little bit hacky to do so, I used the object name again, but with a more robust approach. Let's take the oven blower as an example. In Blender, I named the object starting with ref, followed by the group it belongs to. So cookie, followed by whatever the object is, blower. In JavaScript, I traversed every child of every model I load, and if it starts with ref, I save it in a map after removing the ref part. But I don't just save an object, I save an array of objects in case I need to save multiple references with the same name. Also note that Blender doesn't support having multiple objects with the same name and will add a number at the end, which I also remove before saving. You get to love regular expressions, at least I do. But it's not over. I added a getStartingWith method to retrieve every reference starting with a specific string, hence the cookie at the beginning of the reference name. I returned a new map only containing objects from that group matching the search, and I also removed the group from the name. This way, by calling getStartingWithCookies, I retrieve every reference I need for the cookie stand and I send it to the cookie stand instance. And in that cookie stand class, I can do this references get blower at the zero index, because remember, it's an array, even though there is only one element in this case. It's a little bit complex, but so handy in the end, and I'm going to use it for so many components. I really like the small multiplayer features I started to add, so I decided to integrate a counter on the cookie stand. Whenever someone accepts a cookie, it increments for everybody. No restriction, you guys can just smash the enter keys for hours. For the text, I use a 2D canvas texture, like for the interactive areas, and the size is dynamic according to the current value. I hope to see millions and millions of accepted cookies. I decided to keep the overlay animation, but with a small extra. The overlay now appears with a diagonal offset so that it's not too abrupt. I first calculated a value that goes from 0 in one corner to 1 in the opposite corner. To do that, I used the length of screen UV ScreenUV is a TSL node providing screen coordinate from 0 to 1 on the x-axis and from 0 to 1 also on the y-axis. And I divided its length by 1.414. Can you guess why this number? Well, because the length of this segment is the hypotenuse of this triangle. And square root of 1 power of 2 plus 1 power of 2 roughly equals 1.414. And I get a value from 0 to 1. Is it the best way to do that? Probably not. Will I improve this formula again? Probably not. And I then modulated the value a little and applied it to the initial masking. During the alpha, I kept the server terminal open on my side screen, just to see what users were doing and in case the server crashes. But the logs were barely readable. So I implemented two types of logs. Visual logs with informative data and some colors, just to have it always open on one of my screens. And for the colors, I used the Shulk library. And file logs in which I save every activity like connection, disconnections, WebSocket messages, etc. as raw, in case I need to check the history following potential problems. For this, I use the Winston library, which handles everything I could need like the timestamp, JSON encoding, file rotation, etc. I might need more monitoring tools at some point, but that will do for now. I'm sure you noticed my new statue. I hope you guys recognize the Doom Slayer from Doom the Dark Ages. Great game, had a lot of fun and huge productivity drop for 2 days. Let's say it was for inspiration. Alright, back to the projects. On my old portfolio, I used those billboards with text on the floor. Nothing too fancy, but quite efficient. Unfortunately, it came with two main issues. Adding a new project was a little bit of work, and the user needed to drive a lot in order to see all the images and all the projects. For the new portfolio, I could go for a simple HTML UI, but that would be too easy and break the immersion. So I started working on some concepts and I settled on this. The player needs to park at a very specific location, the camera zooms on a little project's scenery, a billboard displays the current project with various info around it, and some objects help the user navigate. The main piece is this board, and it contains the current project with the title at the top, the URL right below and a 60 by 9 plane for the images. At the bottom are squares and arrows to navigate between the images of the project. On the sides, we can see the adjacent projects, so the next one and the previous one. A pole on the right displays project-related info, such as my role in this project, other developers on this project, and for what company. At the bottom, a table contains the distinctions the project won, including awards, FWA, and CSS design. A circular counter delimits where the player should go, with a carpet in the same style as for the cookie banner, and the interactive area on top of it. A little black board on the left shows the controls. And finally, a nice little candle with the flame lighting up at night, just because it looks cool. I tried to keep a color code where red is for images navigation, purple is for the project's navigation, and yellow is for informative stuff. Interacting with the area moves the camera at a nice angle and locks the car. We can leave by pressing Escape or by moving backward. Pressing the left and right keys from the keyboard moves to the adjacent images or the adjacent project if there is no more image left, with some nice twist and scale and spin animations. pressing Enter opens the current project in the new tab. And the blackboard showing the controls wiggle every few seconds until the user starts navigating. I also placed a pendulum nearby so that the user's sight is attracted toward the controls. As you can see, there are plenty of text everywhere. Like for the interactive areas and the cookie count, I used 2D canvases. In Blender, I created planes where I want text. In JavaScript, I created a text canvas class, handling text drawing in a 2D canvas and providing a 3.js texture of it. That text canvas class isn't too complex, but it supports everything I need, such as multilines, line height, automatic centering, etc. And it can also provide the current text size so that I can resize elements in the scene, such as the purple panel behind the URL. For the images, I created a 16x9 panel in Blender. In JavaScript, I created a material to which I send only two textures at a time, the current texture and the upcoming one. When the user navigates, I immediately start the transition, regardless of the loading state of the upcoming image. If it's already loaded, then it will be displayed immediately. If it's not loaded yet, I show a dark color and fade the image in as soon as it's loaded. But here's the thing, whenever I show an image, I immediately start loading the next one. This way, if the user doesn't navigate too fast, he will never have to wait for an image to load. Especially since images are only 960 by 540 and are well compressed in WebP, making them quite small and fast to load. Creating textures at runtime like this can result in a small stutter during the experience because of the buffering. Fortunately, since the images are facing the camera, I was able to switch to a linear filter for both the minification and the magnification without much of a visual difference, making the MIP mapping unnecessary and thus reducing memory usage. I will have to run some tests, but the stutter seems to be barely noticeable. For the transition, I added a parallax effect to the images. Let me show you. This is without the parallax, and this is with the parallax. It helps on soothing the animation. You might have noticed that the text and images aren't too much affected by the light shading, unlike the rest of the scene. To do that, I mixed between a fully shaded output when we are driving around, to a mix between a shaded and non-shaded version when we open the project. I kept a slight color shading and discrete shadows for the immersion, but it doesn't affect the image too much and texts are clearly visible. And when we close the project, I transition back to the fully shaded version. And it was time to add cursor support. I wanted the user to be able to click on all relevant elements, such as the adjacent projects, image pagination, and the URL. First, I created a cursor class with the addIntersect method in order to use it from wherever I need cursor interactions. Here's what it looks like to add cursor support for the next project panel. First, you can see that I retrieved the reference using the references system previously mentioned. In the case of this specific interaction, I created a simple empty sphere. It is not a triangle-based sphere, just a reference that I use to then create a 3.js sphere. Again, not a triangle-based sphere, just a mathematic sphere. In the Cursor class, I use the traditional raycaster to orientate a ray according to the camera and mouse position, but instead of using the classic intersect objects method, which is used against triangle-based geometries, I use the intersect sphere method from the ray itself. I learned that from the mesh bound helper in React 3 Dre. The idea is that we test mathematical shapes such as sphere and box 3 instead of triangles, which is a lot more performant. And the cool part is that my cursor class supports most traditional cursor events such as enter, leave, down, up, and click. This way, I was able to change the material of the arrows when the cursor hovers the panel, because it's important to have a visual feedback when hovering a clickable element. And I was also able to change the CSS cursor to pointer, like a link. And finally, when we click on it, we go to the next project. I did that for all the clickable parts, and only the URL had to rely on triangles intersection testing, but it's fine, it's only two triangles that won't hurt. Even better, I can deactivate the testing so that I don't recast the projects if the user didn't even open it. Even though I know it's not the best possible UX, I'm quite proud of the result I have so far. There is still work to do, like improving the drop shadows, which look really bad when seen from this close. I also want to improve images loading and maybe load a resolution that suits the user screen size. I will obviously have to add controller and touch support. And finally, now that I have those projects working, I will be able to do something similar for the lab, which is something that was always missing in my old portfolio. I have so many experiments I want to share. Maybe I could put the lab around here. Wait, who put that here? That looks scary. 63? What the hell? Anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed this devlog. I will probably start working on the lab and do minor fixes here and there. Don't forget to follow me on X or Blue Sky for granular updates, and I will see you in the next devlog.